good y'all, it's your boy Ross back again with another video. So we're gonna be checking out 10 WWE wrestlers who received their real vengeful receipt in the ring. So basically they got their revenge in the ring, legitimately. This is gonna be a good one. Interested to see this. I'm sure there's gonna be plenty of backstory behind each of these segments, but appreciate all the love and support, man. Roll to 70K and let's get right into this bad boy.
A receipt is a term that refers to a wrestler getting even. A receipt can take many forms. It can be physical, mental, or verbal in nature. Yep. Receipts are part and parcel of the wrestling industry. There have been a number of incidents in WWE over the years of wrestlers getting their revenge in the squared circle. Now, this is never encouraged by WWE management, but there's little that they can do to prevent this from happening. But which times were they? Well, join us now as WrestleMania looks at 10 WWE wrestlers who got their receipt in the ring.
Oh man, this is gonna be a good one. I think I've seen some of these I actually have seen, so.
Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell for daily wrestling videos and follow us on Facebook for exclusive lists. Number 10, Hardcore Holly on Rene Dupree. Hardcore Holly earned a reputation during his time in WWE for being somewhat of a bully. Yep. He always seemed to have an issue with younger talent and he often took his anger out on them in the ring. Hardcore Holly took issue with young superstar Rene Dupree back in 2004 after Hardcore Holly allowed Dupree to borrow his rental vehicle. The vehicle was then issued with a parking ticket and Dupree ultimately failed to pay the fine. Oh. But instead of communicating with Dupree, Holly decided to retaliate by legitimately attacking Dupree during a live event tag team match. Dupree was brutalized by Hardcore and he received a black eye and bruises across his face. Quite rightly, WWE fined Holly a total of $10,000 for the incident, and hopefully Holly learned a valuable lesson. Number 9.
Something leads me to believe the stories I heard about him. He definitely didn't care.
The Big Show on Stone Cold Steve Austin. Now it's time for a little more of a light-hearted incident of a superstar getting the revenge in the ring. Back in 2002, The Big Show was wrestling Stone Cold at a WWE house show, and during the match, Austin decided to randomly begin to stiff Big Show during the match. Austin was never known for being overly stiff in the ring, but on this occasion, he decided to really lay into the 7-foot giant. Big Show eventually got tired of Austin's antics and he decided to grab him by the face, threw him in the turnbuckle, and laid into Austin both physically and verbally. Hilariously, Austin responded by saying, "There you go, kid, way to fire up." Austin was simply having fun with the former WWE champion, and there was obviously no malicious intent. The duo were on good terms back in 2002, and they remained good friends until this very day.
And that's dope. Not saying that, you know what I'm saying, legitimately trying to hurt somebody, but Austin, and plus back in that era, Austin was the type to, you know what I'm saying, to really, you know what I'm saying, try to get some fire out of you if he didn't feel like, you know what I'm saying, you was bringing that intensity. I could see Austin doing that, and then the Big Show was like, "Hold on, bro, you got me messed up." And that was more of some lightheartedness, like, "I can throw some too." He's like, "All right, bet." And he, you know, they didn't get mad, so that's cool. That's some kind of building some camaraderie with your fellow wrestler.
Number 8, JBL on the Blue Meanie. At the One Night Stand pay-per-view in 2005 was supposed to be a celebration of all things ECW. Uh-huh. For the most part, the pay-per-view was just that, but an incident between JBL and the Blue Meanie almost overshadowed the pay-per-view for all the wrong reasons. During a brawl between the WWE and ECW wrestlers, JBL began to legitimately punch the Blue Meanie right in the head. Meanie would be covered in blood, and the reason behind this was because Meanie made negative comments about JBL online. JBL waited until the brawl to get his revenge on Meanie, and although JBL felt justified in his actions, he was condemned by the fans, superstars, and even WWE management. And number 7.
Yeah, that sounds about right. I remember that. JBL was an asshole too, bro. No cap. JBL was actually an asshole back then from the backstage stories and stuff. Yeah, he was an ass.
Stevie Richards on JBL. And one of the superstars who wanted revenge on JBL for his actions at the 2005 One Night Stand pay-per-view was Stevie Richards. Richards was a close personal friend with Meanie, and there was no way that he was going to let JBL get away without any repercussions. But 1 month after the incident, WWE decided to book JBL versus the Blue Meanie on SmackDown. This would act as JBL's punishment as he ended up losing to the Meanie in a shocking upset. Richards would then interfere in the match, and he would clonk JBL with one of the most sinister chair shots in WWE history. JBL certainly had it coming, and Richards would even publicly claim following the match that JBL finally got what he deserved.
Bro, That chair shot was mean, bro. Not protected at all. God damn.
Number 6, Jake the Snake Roberts on Macho Man Randy Savage. The feud between Jake Roberts and Macho Man Randy Savage was one of the standout rivalries in the early 90s. The most notable segment in the rivalry was the time that Jake Roberts allowed his snake to brutally bite Savage. Savage would be tangled in the ring ropes, and this allowed Roberts' snake to latch onto Savage's arm. Now, according to Roberts, Savage was extremely reluctant to take part in this segment backstage. In fact, Savage only agreed to allow the snake to bite him if Roberts took a bite from the snake first. In fact, Savage actually thought that there was venom in the snake and didn't want to be double-crossed. Roberts stated that he was furious with Savage's request, but Roberts knew that this rivalry was the biggest feud of his career, so he obliged.
The snake has got his bit right in the face!
Roberts would get his revenge by paintbrushing the snake before it was let out of the bag. This made the snake agitated, and therefore when the snake dug its fangs into the skin of Savage, that snake refused to let go. This was one of the more sinister ways a superstar got their revenge in the WWE, but nevertheless, it made for a fascinating story.
Holy wow, bro, wrestling back then, dog. I've seen this image plenty of times, and it's always like, yo, this is, whew. No, but once again, back then, kayfabe was real, bro. Kayfabe was alive and well. I can't do it. I can't do it, man. And you couldn't pay me enough to get bit by anything. You know, not, especially not no goddamn snake. I don't care if it's devenomized or whatever they call it. Nah, I'm good, bro. I'm good.
Number 5, Hardcore Holly on Brock Lesnar.
Okay,
when Brock Lesnar broke Hardcore Holly's neck during a match in 2002, fans expected Holly to come back with vengeance. Holly returned in late 2003, and he was instantly thrown into a high-profile feud with Lesnar for the WWE title.
I think I missed
fans
it.
Expected Holly.
I think he dropped
when
him
Brock
on
Lesnar
the
neck. Broke Hardcore Holly's neck during a match in 2002, fans expected Holly to come back with vengeance. Holly returned in late 2003, and he was instantly thrown into a high-profile feud with Lesnar for the WWE title. Holly was incredibly stiff in the match with Lesnar, and it was clear that he was trying to attain revenge in any way he could. The issue was that Lesnar was one of the toughest, most legitimate superstars on the roster, and when he attempted to be stiff with a future UFC star, Lesnar responded with equal tenacity.
Yep.
Number 4, APA on The Public Enemy. When the APA faced off against The Public Enemy back in 1999, the APA went into the match with one thing on their minds, revenge. The Public Enemy were causing issues backstage before the match, and both members of the APA decided to handle things in the ring itself. The Public Enemy reportedly didn't like the planned finish of the match, and they were making life difficult for both Bradshaw and Farouk. In the match itself, the APA brutalized
God
the duo,
damn.
And the match turned into one of the most infamous legitimate shoot matches of all time.
Damn.
Number 3, Ron Simmons.
They were beating their ass, for real, God damn.
Ahmed Johnson. Speaking of the APA, APA member Ron Simmons was seriously injured in a match back in 1997. This match was against Ahmed Johnson, and Johnson kicked Simmons with that much power that he managed to damage Simmons' liver.
Damn.
There had already been a ton of complaints in relation to Johnson's style of wrestling, but to cause injury to an opponent's liver was the icing on the cake.
Damn.
Ron Simmons returned to the ring, he decided to take revenge on Johnson in a scheduled match. During the match, Simmons would shoot on Johnson, breaking 3 of his ribs in the process.
Oh.
Johnson found out the hard way why being reckless and dangerous in the ring isn't the best.
Damn, he broke his ribs? Best
move for your health or your career. Number 2, Stone Cold on Booker T. One of Booker T's first rivalries when he first joined the WWE back in 2001
Epic
was
segment.
With Stone Cold Steve Austin. The two had a number of matches with one another, and in some of the matches, Booker was overly stiff with the Texas Rattlesnake. Austin would state that one time Booker hit him so hard that he had no choice but to exact revenge. According to Booker, Austin got his revenge by simply booting the former world champion right in the face. Booker revealed,
But the receipt I remember getting back was a stomp right to the face when I was laying down on the ground. And it was a stiff shot right to the nose. And the thing is, I felt like I deserved that. You know what I mean? It didn't bust me up or anything, but it was a stiff shot. And it was purposely done. Now, in business, a man could only respect that.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? That's the way I remember that going. Now, should I have been, you know, in the back, you know, waiting on you behind the curtain before that stiff shot? No, because I delivered the stiff shot first. and the receipt was there given. So I understand that. I totally understand that, you know.
And that's kind of how it was back then. I don't know if it's like that now. But yeah, I mean, he was being a little stiff. Stone Cold said, hey, calm that shit down. There's nothing wrong with that. And, you know, go on about your day. It's, you know, handle like men, go on about your day.
Now, although there was an apparent issue between the two men when Booker first joined the WWE, the two wrestling legends quickly formed a strong bond and would go on to work with each other on a number of projects over the years. And number one, The Undertaker on Randy Orton. Back in 2005, Randy Orton found out why you should never cross The Undertaker. Orton was in the midst of an epic feud with the Dead Man, and during a segment on SmackDown, he would hit The Undertaker with a botched chair shot.
Ooh.
The steel chair caught The Undertaker at an awkward angle, and this busted Taker off wide open.
Ooh.
Taker would wait until the Armageddon pay-per-view to give Orton his comeuppance. The match between the two just so happened to be a Hell in a Cell match. In the match, Taker would inform Orton that his receipt was coming.
Oh, no! That's so imagine you in a Hell in a Cell match, and The Undertaker tells you, just know your receipt is coming.
Bro.
And you know legitimately, oh fuck, he's about to, oh shit, he's serious. Oh my god, that's funny.
And proceeded to give Orton a chair shot to the head, but according to Orton, Undertaker protected Orton as much as possible. Taker managed to get his revenge by making Orton think that he was going to be hurt in the match. Physical revenge clearly was in the Phenom style.
And that's smart. That's smart. He played him. He thought he was legitimately about to get hurt, but it was just more of a psychological thing. And that's just the testament to the Undertaker's professionalism, man. But this was a dope video, man. I enjoyed this. Comment down below. Let me know what part was shocking to you. What part that you didn't know? I didn't know about the Randy Orton situation. I thought that was pretty interesting. I like how he didn't actually get his get back. You know what I'm saying? He got his get back psychologically. I like that. So appreciate all love and support, Road to 70K. Appreciate y'all kicking with me. See y'all on the next one. Peace.